All right. Thank you, the organizer, for letting me present for the second talk. The talk is IRF Dynamic Library Injection. I'm Kenneth Hoon, and I'm the technical lead IRF engineer at Property Guru. So my interests are in agile software development, extreme programming, writing tests, and in previously, I gave a talk in July meetup, and the talk was about XCUI test and how you can write and run acceptance BDD Gherkin test straight from Xcode without any external third-party tool. So today, I'll talk about code injection using iOS Dynamic Library. I'll start off with sharing a short little story about me playing the game Pokemon Go. Yeah. So next, I'll describe the game plan for creating iOS mod apps. And lastly, I'll show you a demo of code injection. So, I was trying to play this game. This game was launched in 6 August 2016. I was having breakfast with my wife at Serangoon Gardens. And across the table, I saw some kids starting to play what looks to be Pokemon Go. So of course, we were excited, we took our app, we downloaded it. And then this game is about to physically move around and catch monsters. So observe for a while. And it suddenly occurred to me that I could actually break the game. So on the first day of launch, I rushed back home, and by noon, I was actually using Xcode to start to do location spoofing. Yeah. And somehow I was obsessed, not with the game, but trying to break the game. So I went even further a week later. I built a Mac app just to locate and spoof. And then I somehow scan and get a Go Radar API. And I end up building this. So this is a Mac app whereby it gets the API calls, and then here it will show the list of monsters. When I click on one of them, the app will actually create a waypoint GPX file. And I have a script, an Apple script, that automatically picks up the waypoint file and submit location Xcode. And that's how I jump from A to B anywhere in Singapore to catch monsters. Yeah. So it's funny because I think during the same time there was an article saying that, hey, there's this guy who managed to find all the monsters in Pokemon Go. So, and then he happened to be an iOS developer, so I laugh out loud. So I was sharing this with my colleagues. Then one day my colleague, he came to office. Your setup is not so good because you have to set up all these things, Mac app, run a script in the background, and you have to be seated next to a Mac in order to break the game. But now, he showed me this. It's actually a mod version of the Pokemon Go app. And you can see there's extra buttons and a joystick over there. It's pretty cool. So how do I install this Pokemon Go app? Somebody actually created a website just to allow people to download and hack to break the game. So it's over here, Pokemon Go hacks.me. Okay, how do I install this mod? So when you go to the website, one of the software that you need is CD Infector. This is a tool that allows you to get an IPA file, re-sign it, and help you to install this IPA file onto your phone. And the cool thing about this is it works with jailbroken devices. Sorry? Yeah, it's cool, man. You can go home and try. Yeah, so to download the software, you can go to cdinfector.com. So, what do you need? You need firstly the mod app. You need your Apple developer account. Then you need the cdinfector. You can use your own non-jailbroken device. With the cdinfector, you provide the mod IPA file. And then log in with your Apple developer account. Then install your non-jailbroken app into your non-jailbroken phone. Okay, so this first part, I'll just show you how to install this onto your phone. Alright, so come out. Let's see. So I have this app.
Yeah.
On the left. Yeah. She's annoying. Alright. So I have this CDN Inspector app. All I need is so you can get your IPA file. So this is the mod IPA file that someone has created. So now I connect it to my phone. Okay, let's set up my phone. Now what I have to do is just take this, drop it into CDN Inspector, log in with your Apple developer account, and it starts to do its work. So what Inspector does, it will go into your keychain, find your developer key, and then logs into your iTunes Connect. It does a lot of stuff. Logs into your iTunes Connect and try to get your developer provisioning profile, and with these two items, it goes into IPA file and resigns all your resources. Signs all your resources as your own. I mean, as your own developer. So the output of it is an IPA file that is actually signed by you. And with that, developer provisioning profile, you can install it straight into your phone. But if you do this, the app only lasts for 7 days because it's a developer created app. So it takes about one minute plus.
So you mean you have to resign it every 7 days?
Yeah, because the app is not done by you, it's signed by somebody else. Correct. So if it's signed by somebody else, you cannot install the phone because you don't have a matching provisioning profile. So what this does is go through all the files and go through all the code signatures, resize everything from all the way to bottom, all your frameworks, and then the last part, resize the whole app. Okay. So now let me show you this app. So of course when you try to do this, you need to trust the developer. General. Okay, trust. Okay. So how many of you have played with this? How many of you have played Pokemon? How many of you have tried the mod app? Nobody, right? Yeah. So if you're still playing Pokemon and you want to break the game, so this is an option for you. So you can see, can I move away? I have a joystick. I have a special button on the top left. There's an M there. Let me log into Pokemon. Takes a while. Now we are really going in. Okay, we are, I think we are in Suntec City, as you can see. So
you go to Changi Village, there's some crazy, very valuable Pokemon.
Yeah, we can go. I don't know why the... Hold on. Maybe we need to restart. Because sometimes, I don't know why the Poke stops and the monster don't appear. Load. So can you wait up? Okay, so everything's here. So let's go to the Pokestop. This is the format statue. It is somewhere in this area. It is right. So we are there. So let's try to show you what this does. Opens a secret console. You can fake location. let's choose backing, the backing speed. So see, yeah. So now with the joystick, I can move anywhere you want. Yeah. So that is the mod. So if you're interested in some stuff, if you're interested, you can go back and try out this mod yourself. Okay, back to the. Back to the slides. Yeah. All right. Cool. So you saw me installing the app. But there's something interesting I want to highlight. So this is the pre-recorded video. At this stage, I've installed the app and really logged in. So I'm relaunching the app. Yeah, so take note, this is splash screen. And now this loading screen, you start to see the joystick as well as the M button. So as you can see, the joystick and the hacking settings button are shown while in the loading screen. So that is a clear indication of code injection. So because firstly, who would actually put controls on the loading screen? That makes sense. So you might think that this it looks complicated to build something like this, but with some simple guidelines and some tools, it is possible for anyone to create a mod similar to this. And today, we will attempt to create our own mod version of Pokemon Go app live in this November meetup session. Alright? Okay, I talk about code injection. So, basic code injection is introducing external codes into an existing software system. You might be familiar with code injection attacks like SQL injection, HTML script, command injection, remote script injection. For me, think about this this way. It's like injecting things into your body. So code injection can be introducing code into an existing system for investigative purpose to find out how things react when you inject something in. Or like Wolverine, you can actually inject codes into a system and then bring about a change in behavior. Like for Wolverine, I think adamantium is inserted into him to make him indestructible. So then another thing I want to talk about is the Xcode. Xcode compiles apps statically. That's why it's able to highlight compilation errors for codes in the project that cannot be statically linked. But during the build phase, Xcode tries to link the codes in your project with external binaries like your frameworks, your static libraries, and perform the necessary checks. Xcode will also tell you if there's any duplicated binaries in your project. For example, if you happen to add two dynamic libraries, you have the same binaries, you probably experience that Xcode will have to complain about duplication of binaries in the app. However, in the packaging phase, Xcode does not guarantee all dependencies will be available during runtime. That's why sometimes when you build apps, especially in Swift, you might encounter things like delete library not loaded. It could be a Swift call in the Swift library, or it could be an external framework. So okay, we know that we need to create a library. Some code. What are the options? We can use dynamic library by going to CocoaTouch framework, or you can create a static library, the second option. So static library, a unit of code that links at compilation time, can we use it? Probably not, because in order to use the static library, it has to be available when you compile the main app. Can we use dynamic library? A unit of code means that runtime that may change. Yes, we can use dynamic libraries because it allows the main app to be compiled and packaged, and after that we can actually link the new codes into it. However, we will need to introduce the the new codes by using the install and load command. It needs to be executed on the IP itself before we do the final signing of the app. So here's the game plan for creating iOS mod apps. We get the original IPA file. We create our own dynamic library. And then boom, put them together. That's called patching. And then we have our own patched IPA file, which is our mod app. And then we take the IPA file with the Apple developer account. We use CDN packet like what I did just now. And then we install it into our phone. However, it may not be easy for us to get access to the original IPA file because in order to extract the file, you need a jailbroken device to be able to take out the file. So if you want to find the original files, the IPA files, you may want to need to go to third-party content providers like iPhone to get them. Okay, so here's too much talking and too much PowerPoint slides. Here's the demo. And my codes are available in this over here at my repository. Okay, let's try to do this. And let me get out of the, let me mirror my display. Okay, cool. So this is the expo project that I have. There are two main targets. The dynamic library, I call it a patch, Pokemon Go. And that target is the baseline app. So what we attempt to do is to create, I'll show you the baseline app, what it does, and I'll show you the codes for the dynamic library. And when I put these two together, and I'll show what happens to the baseline app. So okay, so let's install. Okay. So here's our app. So in the baseline app over here, over here it's just nothing special. A view controller with a MK map view. Nothing special over here. So allow access. So I'm at Suntec City. Nothing special. So this map view will just showcase, will show where the user currently is. Nothing special. Let me stop the app. So these are the classes that I use for patching the baseline app. I'll start off with an Objective-C class. When we package the app, we actually tell the app to load the library into memory before you start building the app. All the classes that are in the library will be loaded into the app. So when this class is being loaded into memory, you have this method that will be triggered. It only triggers when it's loaded into memory, and it happens before the app starts. So this part of the code is where we do all the magic that we need to do. So I have two classes. First one is location scheduler. So what I try to do is to confuse the app, the main app. Look at this scheduling code. So look at this scheduling code. So what it does is, CL location has an IVAR coordinate. So whenever any class wants to access coordinate, I say instead of by scheduling, it would instead of getting the coordinate, I'll say go and find this method located in this class, say coordinate. Instead of giving you the actual location of the user, I give you something else, which is a static IVAR of this class. And this location, I have decided to set it as Raffles City. So I have another swindling method. I have another function that tries to do swindling, but somehow it's not very active, not really working well for me. So I'm swindling the setDelegate method on the location manager. So when any class tries to use the setDelegate, instead of calling the delegate setter method, call setDelegate for manager method inside this class. Because in here, I have an extension with the implement method. So when somebody wants to set a delegate, I want to capture the instance of the CL location manager. So I say location manager self, and after that call back the original method which I switched away, so that everything is working fine for the main app. So what I'm trying to do is to intercept a line of code in this implementation. Okay, so what does my patch loader do? When it's loading into memory, I will do the swizzling before the app starts. And I'll say, after about 2 seconds, use the patch manager and hijack the window. So what does patch manager do? Basically, it will try to capture the UI application and get the window. And once you have the window, the instance of the window is actually a subclass of UI view, you can do a lot of things with it. So what I do, I actually create a label called iOS Desktop Rocks, later you see. And then I create some buttons, north, south, east, west. And what these buttons do is very simple. It changes the that long value of the current location IVAR that we have earlier on. So that will actually help us to move around. Alright, so let's create our dynamic library. So I will just clean everything I built. Bam, bam, bam. Okay, it's over here. So now I want to add this into my baseline app. So I think I go. Embed this guy. I make sure that under embed framework, we insert the framework in. Okay, can. So now I will show you my phone. Now let's delete the old app. Okay. And I will install it into the phone. So we are in Suntec City. My coach said I want to swizzle and be at Raffles City. So notice I did not do anything if the baseline app is still the same. So let's say this. And where am I now? I'm no longer in Suntec City, I'm somewhere else. So in fact, I actually intercepted the UI window and add my own views on top of it. So let's try to do some cool stuff. So the circle represents where I am. I can actually fake my current location by walking. That's this part of the code which is not very responsive, but as you can see, I'm actually moving around. But I'm not physically walking, I'm actually here in Suntec. Okay, so this is code injection straight out from Xcode. Very simple to do, but what we really want to do is to take a production app that you download from the App Store and really do something to it. Because many times you don't even have access to the source code and to even build the whole app together. So let's try to mod the production app. So firstly, I need to prove, you know, it's like a magic show. I need to show you that I'm really having, this is the original, I IP file which is not modded. Like making sure I have to show you that I have no tricks up my sleeve. So you notice in this talk I'll be using CD Vector to pick up IP file and put it to my phone. So far any questions? Any questions about it? Are you guys excited about it or is this boring or what?
It's great.
It's great, right? You know how many evil things you can do with this?
But is there any way to prevent this?
Ah.
Yeah, you just open up a Pandora box.
Yeah, it's all recorded. How nice. How do I prevent it? I have not done the research to prevent it because there's, I don't know, one way is probably for the app. The app might need some codes to recognize, I don't know, the signature of, to recognize the signature whether or not this app is, I don't know, the app itself is signed by the, when it's launched, it's signed by the actual developer. So, I don't know, maybe it's another topic for me to present next time. Okay. So I need to trust the developer. Alright. So there's no tricks up my sleeve. This is as original as it gets. I'll show you that we are really at Suntec City. Alright. So no joystick, no funny features here. I'm starting. So okay, I this is the place. Sky Garden Fountain, is this in Suntec City?
Yes.
Yes, oh, nice. Okay, so this is as real, this is the original thing. I did not do any magic with it. So, let's kill it. Okay. So now let's do the actual magic. This first. Okay. So, this is our dynamic framework. So what we need to do is to grab the binary, the dynamic library binary. The framework is basically a folder with a lot of things inside. You can actually add there's headers, there's other frameworks. You can add your resource bundles, a lot of things. But all the core logics, the four files that we have is actually inside this binary. So we copy it out. And we go to the repository that I have. So this folder contains the Expo project that I'm showing to you. So now go to this folder and paste the dynamic library here. Okay, so I'll show you. So this is the same one that I have. I actually copied and put inside this folder. Okay, so this, can you guys see that? I don't know how to make this bigger. So I'm running this code. I have a shell script. Call the shell script and provide the IPA file, the original IPA, the IPA file you need to mod, and the folder with all the dynamic libraries. So in this dynamic library, this is what I want to mod. This is the dynamic library I want to inject into the IPA file. And as you can see, there are a lot of Swift dynamic libraries here. Because out of the box, your phone, your devices do not know how to really run Swift. It needs the dynamic libraries. So what I did is I just took the Swift libraries and dump it here. If I were to write everything Objective-C, I wouldn't need this delete files. Where can I find this? You can actually find the find this dynamic libraries, go to your application, open up Xcode, content, developer, toolchains, default toolchains, userlib, Swift. And here are all the devices available. And for the phone, these are the delete dynamic libraries. If you want to do it for your iPhone simulator, here are the equivalent ones. Because they are actually built in a different architecture. So you can... What I did, I actually copied everything in for simplicity's sake. Otherwise, I have to add one by one and try to run the app. If it crashes, there's a message telling me which delete is missing. I have to add it one by one. So for simplicity's sake, I just dump everything in. So I go back to my project. So here we are. And now I try to run this command. I think it takes about a minute. So what this does is to go through all the deletes in the folder and to run the install load command. Actually, it opens the IPA file and then it creates a folder called, I think, delete or framework, copies all of those deletes that are in that folder I specified, copy in and then run through a loop that picks up all the files and does the install load command. So after that, it's like a box, you need to close the box. So this is the last part. I'm deleting all the temporary files, moving folders from here to there.
Question.
Yep.
When you are making your own dynamic library, do you need to match the exact variable name with the original? Or
what do you mean by?
It's like when you want to overwrite the player's location, do you need the exact instance name from the original?
You may need. So that's why it's actually not easy to mod the app, because you manage the black box, you put your hand in and you try to figure your way out.
Yeah.
But all you know is that you're providing input, and maybe you are just, what you can do is do it investigatively and print out maybe the class names or methods. But you may not know how it works. So it takes time to put in certain codes and see the output, put in certain different codes, see the output. It's actually quite painful.
Okay.
So actually it wasn't easy for me to mod, to spoof the location, but there are people out there who have GitHub repos who have already done this solution, so I just referenced it and then, they do it this way, so I just implement it.
They actually tell you like, okay, you need to call this instance name
No, somebody found out the code is on GitHub, I just copied. But it's not that easy, because firstly, Pokemon Go uses Unity, so I do not know how Unity works. I never used a framework before, so I do not know how to really interact. But I know that the architecture of an iPhone app is, they have a UI window, correct? So that is a given. That's why I placed my buttons on top of it. There's also problems like race condition, because I might be trying to intercept the UI window, but there might be other dynamic libraries, or there might be actual codes that actually try to mess up the UI window. So that's base condition. I don't know. So the only way to find out is to throw in some codes and find out myself. Okay, so about the codes, the shell script. So I take that. Open up the shell script. I did not write this from scratch. There's actually a repo which I give credits to in my repo. In that script does a bit more complicated stuff, like going through, after putting in all the dynamic libraries, you'll try to sign from bottom up, signing all the different libraries at folder levels, going up and all the way to do a final signing. But since I've seen the impactor, which does a lot of heavy lifting for me, I took out that part. And so this is the part that does the magic, basically saying that for all the libraries in these files, run the op2 install load command. So that when the app before it launches, just before it launches, it will put these files, these classes into memory. So what is this op2? op2 is a tool that interfaces with the Apple machine macro binaries and can do things like insert, remove load commands, resign, etc. So if you want to know more about how to play around with the binaries and how to use op2, we can go to this repository. And now I need to show you how the final iOS desktop Pokemon app looks like. Alright, so now I take the patch file, I put it in. So now it's trying to do its magic. It takes about 2 minutes. So meanwhile, any questions?
The Pokemon Go hacking, those codes inside that folder, the codes
in inside here? Which one?
Inside that folder, there's no Pokemon Go hacking.
So I created a repository with these tools to actually do the patching, and this project that you see here is actually this inside this folder. Yeah, so if anybody really wants to find out how things work, you can play around. Yeah. So why I chose Pokemon Go, because it's something that really will get people excited about. Yeah. If I talk about another game, people will be like, people may not know what other games does, but when I talk about Pokemon Go, yeah, they know that it's about walking, it's about throwing the balls. And they know that people are cheating, but they don't know how things are done.
Is there any legal implications, legal and sorry,
like
gray areas?
Gray area? I researched online, so like if you try to cheat your way, somehow the lion thing will come after you. So there's a lot of repositories online that tries to remotely log into Pokemon Go servers and try to pass in all the fake actions. So when you get caught, they will actually find the repository owner and force them to shut down. But my work is actually harmless. I mean basically it's nothing. You can actually dump this into any app. I just take Pokemon as an example. Okay, let's go in. So it takes a while. So an interesting story, it's actually in August that I managed to get this hack working, and I took soup and can I present on, because there's all the hype about Pokemon Go, but I think August slot was taken up, and then September was another workshop, October was a DEF conference, so the earliest I could present was now.
Soup was really busy before the conference.
Yeah, I know. But I think it's a good thing that I present now, otherwise I will really spoil the game for a lot of people. So now you can see the labels there, the buttons are there.
So basically at this screen you can kind of listen and capture what you're typing, like the user type, like the user name password. Are you able to? If you want to.
You can do anything. You really can do anything.
So
in fact, what I do, You can put a keylogger. You can remotely, if somehow you can trick the user to give your location, you can remotely track where they are. Right, you can do a lot of evil stuff. Okay, so now I'm here. I am not in Suntec City. So I can show you, prove to you where I am. I can use the button to move. The left, and I am Swiss Hotel Stamford, which is at City Hall. So I'm there. I can prove to you I can catch something. So I think if the servers detect that you are really cheating, you cannot grab the balls, etc. So let's catch something. Alright, cool. Okay. Alright, so I have moved, I captured the... Ah, shit, how did I get up? I can capture the ball, so... With this mod, I have done something in the game, and I progress into the game. I think I've earned some experience points, etc. So this is how you actually take an IPA file, mod it, and then you can do it for investigative purpose, or you can do it to bend the rules. Yeah, for fun. Yeah. So, any questions? I think I come to the end. Yeah, go ahead.
You're using something called Method Suisse, isn't it?
Yes.
So I've heard it about it, but I've never really read about it. What does it do? What do you do?
Ah, okay.
What do you use it for?
So my colleague Zoe actually gave a talk on in July. So I give an analogy about Suisse. You took the lift to the ninth floor, correct? So your expectation to come up to the ninth floor, assuming that you never come to PayPal, you come to the ninth, press the button, you come to the ninth floor, you see an office, it's PayPal, you walk in. What Suizing does is change the button of the ninth floor and send you to maybe the 16th floor. As for you, you press the ninth floor, it opens up, and you still think it's the ninth floor, but actually you're somewhere else. So what Suizing does is basically changing the logic from taking the logic A and swap it with something else. So that's the method. So the thing about swizzling is the rest of the codes which are not swizzled still thinks that it's working the same way because you're still calling the same method. But instead of running that block of functions that you have in that method, you're running something else. So it kind of mess things up, it confuses things. Yeah, that's swizzling.
Can we say we change the method on the fly by using instantly? Like on one time we just change the implementation? Is it like?
Can we do that? Invanta?
Certainly it's a long time.
Yeah, in Invanta, but it's you have to swizzle it beforehand, right? Correct.
But there's a way you can actually assist, if you can see the differences on a long time,
yeah.
You can actually create the class on a wrong time. You actually send function to script to create the class and create another switcher every time.
True. That's the guy who presented the switching at that time. Any question?
Okay, your talk actually reminds me a bit of Conrad Kramer's talk about reverse engineering the GitHub. Because I think he did talk about but then he goes on to talk about how he sort of extracts the classes or methods from the app with another tool.
Yeah, there is, let me find it.
Yeah.
let me find. It's a tool where you can actually get into the app when it's running and then find out all the methods. Is it the one you're talking about?
Is it like, I think it's called ClassDump.
Yeah, ClassDump. I
couldn't figure out how to use it, so yeah. That's what I'm asking.
I don't know whether this is the one. In fact, maybe this is the one. I think this is the one, the demo. So, I've not tried this out. I think maybe one or 2 years back, there was some guy who did reverse engineering or some hacking on IIS desktop. Someone did a presentation. It's in the Facebook. So, he showcased using a tool where you can see in runtime what. With the app still running in runtime, what are the variables? So I don't know whether you can call it code injection, because for mine is ready to build the code and put it in together, and the main app doesn't even know what's happening. Yeah. So any more questions or any more ideas?
Okay. When you do this model, you cannot put it onto the store, right?
I have not tried, because the binary has its own info query stuff inside, and the it does not belong to me. So I think it's possible to open an IPA file, change those values. I've not tried it, but I also do not want to really do it.
They might
notice. Yeah, suddenly there's an iOS desktop Pokemon Go app there. Anything? We can actually use this method to find out maybe what your competitor is doing, just investigatively. Evil stuff would be like key logging, capturing of information.
Do you see a reason why you want to hack your own app after you publish it?
Hack my own app? I don't know. I really don't know. But I would like to hack my competitor's app. I like to hack some games. I would actually, our friend here talk about how do you prevent. So I might do that to test out whether can I, are there codes that I can use to actually prevent people from modifying my logic. But of course, talking about how do you prevent, always do security on both your client and your server side. Yeah.
So maybe when you send, when you request, an API call or something, you include the...
You want to capture those information?
No, the... what was that called? The so-called... Your developer. Okay, when you send the app, right, it's using a developer profile.
That's right.
So maybe when you call the API, you want to send the developer profile as well to check whether that developer profile is from you or from someone else.
Yeah, but you can actually copy the original one and later put it back in.
Okay.
I mean?
So, seeing as an app that has Firebase as the backend, right? Then, how would you hack into that?
Oh, okay. I'm not a hacking expert. So what I'm actually showcasing is how do you, where do you start? How do you code and inject codes in? But to really do the hacking in this way, you really have to explore how things work, because different apps build things differently. They might use a phone gap or things. You may not have for example, we are in Pokemon Go app, we assume that they are using cell location, but they may not be. They might be, I don't know, getting from some lower level libraries. So I can't tell you offhand how to hack. And this talk is not to how to hack anything out there, but rather what are the clusters that you need, how do you kick the ball? Yeah. So the how to start the ball rolling is actually to create this static void attribute constructor function, and then put all your magic in there. Otherwise, there's no way to run this code, because the main app only knows about its own scope. So here's the magic. And personally, I don't really like this kind of loading. I really don't really like, because it may screw up your app. The cool thing about it is that, you know, sometimes when you work with external SDKs, they just tell you, hey, use this framework, put it into your project, and everything works. But there might be side effects, because there might be race conditions that you may not know of. Right? Yeah. And you might be putting in different SDKs of the same type, or the same that will give you the same behavior. And each of them might be trying to intercept the same object and or scissor here and there. So it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. Maybe I will just do a shout out for my company. Just 1 minute. Like Property Guru is hiring people. So people we have in the IRS team, Suraj, Sohei, over there. We have been like contributing to the IRS event, IRS desktop event with talks. If you're interested to join us, come and talk to us. Yeah. We have development officers in Singapore and in Thailand.